Hi, I'm Viola, and I'm going to speak about art, because I've noticed that the theme of this year's camp has a lot to do about security, privacy, and hacking, and it's actually... So the theme of this camp is security, privacy, and hacking, and I've noticed that these are exactly the themes that I always work with, but from the art scene. So in the art scene, these themes are really researched all the time. And I've also learned in the hacker scene that a lot of hackers always think of art as deco, and there is a lot of bad art. Often when I go to visit art things and I bring my friends or hacker friends, I'm always like embarrassed. But so what I want to do about that is to create the most awesome events that I can think of by finding the best art that I can find in the world. And I want to give you a presentation with a couple of themes. I've prepared a couple of slideshows. One of those slideshows is about cool robots, like the one that you see here. This is an industry robot that has been hacked to use as a turntable. And you can see that we showed this in a big church in the center of the town of Enschede today, where they were just playing tunes and being the DJ there. And it's really nice that artists are really actually very involved in a lot of topics that are also having to do with the hacker scene. They question the power of Google, they work with security, privacy, and they also like doing a lot of cool stuff. And I heard that a couple of years ago, an empire from a tiny teenage riot was at the CCC camp, and he was really asking the hacker scene to work more with the artist scene, but it's really difficult if those scenes are really not knowing each other. So yeah, with this talk, I want to motivate you and to give you enthusiasm into showing some cool art, and to increase the mutual understanding, and perhaps that you will also in the future not only make your own art, but also maybe are more eager to also work with other people who really can desperately need your expertise and your insights and your views on privacy and the world. So okay, now let's start. I have prepared a lot of pictures, and I want to make this also interactive. So I have a slideshow on robots, and I have after that one that is more called, focused on activism. So if you want to see more from one, just scream. I know it's difficult when you're an audience to stand up and scream, because audiences are always really like slow with lingering and shy and afraid, but we're relatively small group, so it's a good thing, it's really positive. So just put your hands up or say skip when it's really boring. Yawning is also good, people I might miss that. So if you're loud and you're young, I know I can skip to the next picture. Deal? Okay. Now, this is at the church. The good thing about art is that we actually reach a broad audience. This event was in the center of a city in the Netherlands, and there were 20,000 visitors here that we tried to educate, that there's not only shopping on the Sunday, but there are more things in life that you can think about. Because a lot of people that are just living in towns, they have no idea about what a hacker is, and that Google could be doing evil stuff. They have no clue. And the way to tell this to the people is to connected with a part of fun, because when it's fun you more easily look at it and you let it more in. So if you're scaring them, that's okay too, because that's what the news does. But when you put it with a fire spitting robot or other fun stuff, then it's that also kind of works. So it's cool, this is really nice. This is a robot that turns around at the speed of 150. I forgot, but it goes like first slow, and then when there are more and more people, it goes like vroom, vroom, vroom. It's really heavy, and if you put your head in, what a lot of young kids do, and you know, pull them out, because it's super dangerous, and the sound coming from this device. Oh yeah, this is a new thing that just came out. It's almost finished. This is me. This is a new exoskeleton built in the Netherlands. And the nice thing about this exoskeleton is that it's connected with the robot. Does this work? Yeah, over there. Oh, I have a big finger. In the back, you can see a robot where it's connected to. So when you kick or when you want to punch, it's really nice to have your robot equivalent who is much bigger and taller and stronger to do the same thing for you. So, yeah, and you can also dance or do other stuff. So I was really happy because it's an experimental thing. So you have to be between 180 and 190 tall to be able to actually fit in the thing. So I was feeling so lucky. I was like, yeah, I will fit in this. And I was, and I hope you will do this more in the future. And you too, I hope. And then here I have some examples of artists playing with tech and dead animals. And oh, this is nice. This is a performance group from Russia. We won with this installation an award for being the best artist initiative of the Netherlands a couple of years ago. And this was about the similarities near resistance is futile. This was about the theory of what would happen if robots would take over. So these girls are really connected as cyborgs with all kind of equipment. Everybody uses drones, biotech screens and sensors that were measuring their brainwaves and reacting on this. With more cool robot stuff like this guy, this is called Titan. He actually performs with Will Smith and he does, he does silly jokes with the audience, like spraying them wet and crying and just stand-up comedy. But people love it. You see that they're all smiling and they all want to see it and they want to shake his hand. So yeah, the thing is that if it looks cool and nice, then you can really more easily convey your message to the world audience which you want to reach, because you want to change the world, at least I do, and make it a better place, and it helps if those people understand or listen what you're talking about. This dog spits fire and he walks over the market square there really with heavy shoes. More interactive robot art. Nice and shiny metal. More interactive installation wheels, cyber plugins for animals. VJ art is also used when you don't want to see only art, because a lot of people that hear art, they think, and a lot of kids, they don't want to go to the museums. So we put art into the streets, into the clubs, places where people go to, and give them a fun experience. This was one was a robot drummer. It can actually drum AC/DC. It's now part of a band. It's called Robocross Band. Titan again. The fire-spitting robot. I just put some stuff up. I've been teaching at the University of Twente as a teacher in the course of creative technology, and I was teaching the students to get to the end product. So this one was about Google Birth. It was a theme, the power of Google. And with this future interface, that you could decide what kind of baby you wanted, like with a high IQ or a high EQ, so you could manually use the sliders on the interface on the screen, and then the baby in the aquarium upgraded became smarter, but you had to pay with your own info, data, money, whatever, credit card. And this also traveled all over the world, because at that time, this was like 7 years ago, it was, the power of Google was a really upcoming theme. And this was a cultural similarity. This guy creates natural forms because he misses them in the town. His name is Daan Roosgaarde, and he puts them back in the cities to have natural shapes with cool lights and interactive objects back into our great cubed city centers. We also like to do lots of video mapping, and every year we always try to either build a robot that eats the church tower or make a gigantic spaceship, because it's fun. Yeah, some quotes about singularity. It was 2010. I heard somewhere that this was the first singularity-based event of Europe, even. Electric fish. Biogenetics on how you create maybe new entities in the world. Why not? And yeah, one superbrain is just a funny thing. People were also, I'm also a fan of them because it's a Belgian theater group and they actually invented the open rift more than 15 years before it actually existed. They were handling a huge laptop on your back and a helmet on your head and you had a video goggles on here and a 360 degrees camera on your head, which was kind of heavy. And also the battery pack was quite heavy, but you could see, for instance, what the other person sees. Or you could create a world which is half real, because you film it, but also half video theater, so you don't know what is real anymore. So nowadays, with AR, that's really a common thing, but we've been experimenting with this like more than a decade ago. And I see that also, like, it's a task of the artist not to only create what's not there yet, but also to like think about it and to learn and to create new ethics and to talk about technology before it actually goes mainstream. And here you see that it also went on for the world. Video mapping. This is an artist group called Yodi. They don't like to paint like some artists do, but they like to use the symbols of Google Maps because it's just more fun than using paint. They're one of the first net artists. Of course, from Mansfort always questions the next nature on how we can use technology in the future or how we can grow our own meat. He's been doing it for also a very, very long time. And Natasha Fittemore was one of the lecturers that we had. Speakers, she was Miss Transhumanist. This was again the Russian girls who were used as cyborgs. This is from Daan Roosgaarde and Martje Dijkstra. He created with her a suit, a dress, and if the woman gets really excited, the fabrics go transparent. So, yeah, why not wear that at a party? If you can, I mean, yeah, much more fun than a normal dress. And this is Stellar. He started in the 80s with this. He actually also once grew an ear in his arm. And this is a spider that he used as a kind of also like an exoskeleton because he just wanted to feel what it was to have spider legs and to connect humans with machines. And yeah, he's one of the first famous people doing this. And we've worked with him a couple of times. Ah, this is the ear that he grew in his arm. This was his first performance on Second Life that he did with us, also using an extra arm to graduate. Do a lot of experiments with laser and just playing with new technology. A lot of artists are also tech or they're getting help from really tech people and they just love to play. And playing is also a new thing in science that you see more coming up because playing leads to unexpected results and testing out what new things can do. Titan again, it's fun. Okay, I'm going to show the next slideshow now. It's not my laptop, so I have to search a little bit. I'm going quite fast. I can go slower if you like, but I think it's a good tempo because I have more than 100 pictures to go. You can scream, what now? Okay, yeah. Well, this is a really short overview of a sponsor meeting thing that I had. Last year we had a lot of partners and sponsors like the European Space Agency who wanted to put a rocket of them in, or we used their materials that were opened for the artists to play with and to think about. And even we had a crew captain that was part of the NASA, and he was in Hawaii for 3 months being locked into a simulation spaceship just to see what psychological effects it has to be 3 months in the same spaceship with other scientists. And what you see is that they were working on in the day on their own projects, and they were going to do that after that on the ISS, but they first wanted to see and test and work with that. And in the evening they were coming together, and the thing that worked best was that they started cooking together, because cooking makes people happy, it really binds them as a team, and it's like a really nice social interaction, and feeding yourself with really proper food is also a really, really nice nice way of doing things. So this artist, Angelo van Meulen, he created more and more experiments with spaceships in all kinds of towns. We were town number 3, and we used the biology students or the architecture students to come up with temporary sustainable ways of them filtering their own wastewater, and they're just using stones and rocks and coal and other things to just learn how to have an independent space station in your town for a while and see how it's done best. And I've been teaching at a lot of universities, like University of Twente, and also working with other universities, and I just made some logos here and did things at the World Expo at IIT in Mumbai. Japan Media Arts Festival. So also the Dutch government is also really supportive in showing the future of art and letting people think about it. Okay, this is a slideshow about activism. This guy has power shock sensors on his body, and he has a device where the people could shock him. So you could press the elbow and he would go, ah, and you could also choose if it would be a heavy shock or not heavy shock. And of course everyone chose the most heavy shock because it was so much fun to see him suffer and to go like, ah. So yeah, it was a nice experiment, and it's also nice to have your own avatar as a human avatar that you can control, and how people work with it and how it makes them feel. This is about fetishizing capitalistic brands like Shell and AT&T and these big brands. Recycled art, the power of Shell in the world, destructive forces, 9-1-1 conspiracies. We got once the US delegation over from the beer brand Schools that sponsored the City for Culture. They were really pissed off because we used it. We also used the 9-1-1 conspiracy tower there that was broke down. And then they say, you use our money for this, and then we had a meeting and they said, no, artists are free, they can choose how to use it on. So I was really happy about this. This is an activist called Jan Staal, and he made an shrine of all dead people, but also, we had never 500 years in the Netherlands, there was no political murder in the last decades. We soon had one after another, and it was so bizarre that there was so much going on that he also made an artwork about it. And another artist made the jihad flag to see what happened. And then of course the Young Liberal Party, they took it down, and they thought that they had to censor news because it was going too far and this is not real art, but it's a lot of news, so perfect. Minneapolis team 2006, this was about neural networks in cities and between people. Interactive art works because it's also, when you have a game or interactive artwork, people more easily get into it and they get more active, and then the distance between them and the art goes smaller because they can also play. And then the whole experience of showing things makes it more fun, and you can take them into deeper layers. This device takes it's from Austria, and it takes the sounds out of the cosmos, and you can hear it in this speaker, and behind it you see a car racing game where the gravity coat was hanged out, so the car doesn't go through the track anymore, but it flies in the sky and bumping into everything and losing part of itself. So it's also like a coat half taken out to see how bizarre things can get. This is one of my favorite works, Belgian group again. You see here about the power of Google, for instance, that the word pollution in English leads to different results than that as the same word in different languages. And you see it also with the word riots in different languages, but in one country that's more about terror and shooting, and in the other one it's more about football. So Google really colors the image that you have on the world. Most people, and also journalists, only use first page of Google to understand what it is that they're looking for. So if they want to learn about the riots, they just only read the first page, maximum the third page, because that's really it. And that's really scary, because then we only read news on what Google shows us as validity, and it's not based on accuracy, but on popularity, because only popular sites go up in Google, or if they pay a lot. We had a lot of Second Life work. Oh yeah, we also love America, we think keep America great. Yeah? Always good. Half-cook safety, not in safety, of course, especially if the government promises this, always trust this. Oh yeah, this is graffiti. It's an open source project, so everybody can do it. It's graffiti, and it doesn't leave any stains because you're using a super big beamer and a laser pointer, so you can just point on a building, write down fuck you, or peace for all, or whatever message you have to the world, and then just beam it on the building. They even put it on cars and have like guerrilla graffiti cars going through town. And
it's called laser graffiti. Legal.
Yeah, just laser graffiti. You can find it on Google.
That you can find it.
Yeah.
And process it.
And this was also about 10 years ago. This guy moves, and then the robots who has limbs out of laser also move in the same direction. Camera surveillance and quotes about this from all over the world. And these are the car bomb racks from Baghdad, because Baghdad, a lot of us know only out of the newspaper, and the newspaper only tells us the news, and they were like, oh yeah, bomb there, here and there. But if you put those car bomb racks in the market square, for a lot of people, they hated art afterwards, but it's also good because it made them think. So that's exactly what we wanted to reach, to show them that not everything in the news is like, in the movie, and therefore either fake or far away, but it's also like, you can see the power which those doors have been crashed with, and that comes like really deeper inside, because you actually see and touch these things, and you smell them, and we thought it was a welcome addition to the news. People are really full with disgust about it. Perfect. We love 8-bit and old game computers still. It's me in the back, not younger. Lots of underground videos and conspiracy theories videos in the world. So, oh yeah, we had 2012, we did some things with anonymous people, and they were speaking about internet memes as a reasonable part of the chip card hacks that we did, or other hacks that we did. So we decided also to have an internet memes edition. And then that year, the designer of the Nine Cats, his lawyer, sent us an email that he saw, or that he heard that we used this Nine Cat in the posters on the railway stations. We were finally happy that the city gave us money for posters on the railway stations, so we finally looked really big and impressive. But then we got this lawyer on the phone, and then we were like, oh yeah, okay, because we also hate copyright, so we think always like, we should just, how can you build art and science when you have to copyright everything that you see, that you can never play anymore, and you're not making profit also. So we're not, so I also told him like, yeah, if you're going to sue, you can. And but yeah, even if you win, we're a non-profit, so we can never pay you. And on the other side, we're not selling it. We're not making any money out of it. So yeah.
But who wanted to sue?
Earn anything. What?
Was it the designer of the Yum Cat who wanted to sue?
Yeah, his lawyer sent us an email and he said that he was shocked by the picture that he saw that Nine Cat was suddenly a top big.
There's some copyright behind Nine Cat?
Well, the designer thought that he designed it, and if other people make profit of this, I can understand that. Maybe.
And what was the end of the case?
Now that I sent him a really long email back on all possible scenarios and explaining that what we do, and I said even if you win, then
it's coming in the middle out of
never pay you.
Sorry,
what?
Isn't the Nine Cat coming out of like the middle of image boards or something? Now there's someone claiming copyright on it.
Well, the whole thing with these internet memes was that it was an evolving thing on the internet, huh? And the internet meme is a creative concept, like a gene that develops over time, that everybody could use to creatively create another version of. So therefore, I thought it was, we have almost every year that a person suing us, or that an artist has a scratch on his interactive work or something. So. Not so worried about that anymore. Yes?
Sorry, that really bothers me now. So,
okay.
I mean, that's part of the definition of a meme, that there is no owner because it's coming out of this, like, crowd identity, like image boards are, like Trump Chen is, like 4chan is, and stuff. So,
yeah, I agree.
So, how did this person ever even be, how was it able to claim copyright? Because somehow, by physics of existence of those memes,
think that he didn't call it a meme when it started, just like the techno Viking. You all know the meme, right? About this really dancing techno Viking guy that was filmed, and he also, that's what I heard, so doesn't like it that somebody filmed him and that he's now so famous, so a lot of people that make memes never have the intention that it's getting into a meme, so it actually gets into a meme because of people reproducing it and liking it and go viral. Most viral videos that you make, they never go viral because they only go viral when the audience really picks it up, so it's the audience or the people that make it into a meme or a viral. But I also thought it was stupid, of course, but yeah, it's the thing that I didn't write in that email, but it's really nice because in art we always try to provoke and it's always great. We were so happy that we could kick against another thing and that we got a lawyer to write this again. I was like, wow, okay, let's see. And I heard from a lot of other festivals that they always get scared when I got sued, but I'm always really happy, you know. Yeah, maybe also because I did my MBA and I did international business law and I did tax law in the study. So and also Dutch law is not about contract law, but it's about reasonability. So if there's no money and no reasonability, then for me it's out of the question to be really acting with fear all the time, which is stupid anyways, because then you're never free to live. Oh yeah, this is about our politicians being resampled. This is Mulder, so he was still a bit younger. And he was using these words all the time, so the artist sampled this to actually show what his most buzzwords were. This was about the bio industry. As you can see, pork and how we treat it. Playing with lights, and this was a team called Metalhead, so about the aesthetics of evil with a lot of black metal and dark metal music. So yes, this was the last day, because what you see on the ground is the festival cups that were in the beginning were all plastic cups, and then after a lot of beer and walking around, they were all squashed and gave you the extra smelly and nice festival experience of real black metal festival. We also had a microphone there and you could scream in it and it would get a grunt out, like you would scream like ah, and you would hear ah, you know, so that was also a lot of kids liked it a lot. Yeah, we also worked with science fiction writers like with Bruce Sterling before this year in a team called Steampunk. On the theme was the primary force of energy and the do-it-yourself and the old craftsmanship mentality versus the throwaway things, products culture that we have nowadays. And then we had this year we had the theme of atomism, which was more about the aesthetics of the 50s. In the 50s we had the nuclear bomb, so, but also nuclear energy. So it was the promise of free energy for everybody and clean, but also the threat of the Cold War and so that the bomb could fall. So it was always like this double threat that technologies brought to us. And then also in the 50s, a lot of science fiction writers started because they were thinking about what this technology could bring. People could suddenly fly for the first time to the moon. And there were a lot of ideas about the future that we should listen to, because a lot of these things they've been tried on, like social housing or living in a shared house with other people, and why they worked or why they didn't work. So the past is actually a kind of future that already happens, said Bruce Sterling. So yeah, we can learn about the future when we take a couple of steps back also, and to see about the fears and the things that happened then, and why future ideologies worked or didn't work out, so other experiments. So yeah, we showed a lot of that, and not always it was really pleasurable, the music and the sounds that we made, because often we use like relays in containers which were really loud, or like was even a boy using a drill to cut the concrete in the streets, and he used that as his musical instrument because it was just super loud or explosive, strong, that in big metal pipes as a huge organ, because one pipe was bigger than the other. So often it was really loud, and you see that the teenagers there are really protecting their ears because it's too loud for them. But they like it, and other people did not, but they still wanted to look because it was just really spectacular. So they really seemed like we're torturing them. And it was really funny, they don't look happy at all, and they keep standing there and watching it. Yeah. So yeah, and it was really cool, like all the times there are like people watching and thinking, what is this now, what's going on? And we do a lot of things with kids also, like we had on the old marketplace, we encourage them to like smash open old technology, old computers, old telephones, old televisions, just first to destroy them and then smash them as hard as possible on the stones on the market square, and then build them into something new, like a Zelda outfit or something with wings or a robot. And kids are always really proud when they make their own toys. And artists can really help with that because it's just much more fun than going to a toy store. Alright, on the left you see one of the caravans that was part of the spaceship, but you don't see the rest of it, it's unfortunate. So there were people inside that for a couple of days looked inside. Also one from newspaper, and then the audience could climb up and stick their heads into a glass dome to see how the experiment was going, if they were in the fight yet. The party also connected. This was a video work about the daughter of a terrorist. That terrorists are not just throwing bombs because they think it's fun, but often it has a reason. And the reason is often because their family got hurt, or their daughter, or something happened, because no sane person just throws a bomb without a reason, I can imagine. And we did more activist things, like big black colored people trashing cars to experiment on what we think about this, or to make it feel closer, or our prejudgments. But yeah, these were just old waste cars that were standing there. We had a virtual world mashup, it was also about 10 years ago, where we were teaching people about the virtual world. And also, this is a gay activism in the sim called the Amsterdam sim on Second Life. where suddenly it started raining pink crosses because of the Iran killing of a couple of young gay boys. And this is also about demo punk and cyberpunk in Second Life. And we always like spaceships. We announced this is a blow up of inflatable architecture. We announced an autonomous rocket launch that we get with the students because we think it's always stupid that only governments can do autonomous rocket launches in their own space, but not the people themselves. And we hacked a road sign when there was a traffic jam. We just took it here and we hacked it and we said, shut down, controller. So, and the fire setting robot. This is an artist that made an anti-smog tower for in the city. It's a huge smog, sucking device that uses negative ions to remove smog in the city. Why not? Or in a smart highway that charges the car when you drive over it, or shows when it's slippery by showing the icons on the road. And they even are testing that out now in the Netherlands. They have now also bicycle pumps that light up, that charge in the day and light up in the night. Circuit bending robots, workshops, sorry. More inflatable works. Performances where technology and when they move, they actually don't only dance but also control the sound. This is a Japanese artist called Suguru Koto. This is in the church again. We had after the Pussy Riot. You know the story, eh? It was activist girls and they didn't like Putin because Putin limited their freedom of speech. So they sang a freedom of speech hate Putin song in a church with his masks on, like this mask with purple and pink and green, and then put him in jail. And then there were women activists in the Ukraine that were writing their activist text on their titties because it's much more red than using a banner, because people don't read it anymore when you hold a banner, and this sells newspapers and goes over social media. And then the mother of the famous activist group and me cut down Christian crosses against the action of the Putin, and I had three riots on the breast, and the mother had fuck church, and this was published in more than 1,000 newspaper articles all over the world. It was the first protest that led to more than 1,000 newspaper articles in the fronts of Russia, in the Ukraine, in Armenia, in Poland, in France. It was like everywhere in the news. And the Russians, Medvedev also reacted on it. They were scared to shit. They were really super scared. They were afraid that we were going to do this all over the world. And there were even newspaper articles saying that because of this action, they were replacing wooden crosses in Russia by steel ones, because they were afraid that we would cut it down with our chainsaws otherwise, and that it would cost one million ruble per piece. And they were all really. And also, Medvedev reacted to the news on this protest. So using media and using things to go viral always work. So when there's like this theory with the triangle of sex, religion, death, and if you pick like two of them or three of them, it always hits the news. And as long as it sells papers or people share it on Facebook, you can be really effective in your protest and activist things. Videos don't really work. Oh yeah, here's one of the newspapers that I translated into English. It's a bit too small. Facebook pages were created about it. All fan groups. The church again. It's today. MTV also shot a clip there to show that the city is cool for the students. Oh yeah, we always like to kick every possible that you see. This was the work of Tinkerbell, and she did a work about pedophilia and the vending machines that you see in Japan, and here you could buy almost 18 plus underwear, and you could choose stained or not stained for $5 or for $3. Stained was $5, this one was stained. And we put them between the Dixies. And this is in the Berlin artist group, like an interactive dance part where you could see your own shades and your tracking. Because it's fun. Technology. And why not? Yeah. And then every year we have a new talent award, so we scout the artworks of the Dutch art academies. And this year I also did some English ones to see which art is the most inspiring to me or to what I think is nice. Just going a bit forward because I'm getting also tired of my own talk. Of brain scanners. More activism. Medusa, Museum of Modern Art, where we hate ourselves into because we put this was in the time that the layer app was new. It was an augmented reality app, so we did the hack into the MoMA, adding our own art like Banksy did, and then we also did an invasion of the Pentagon and of the White House, also adding our own stuff there and our own entities in this virtual layer. And this is an artist that works a lot about it's mapping and how sites are mapped and how things in the world are mapped. His name is Pete Bunting, and he has a lot of mapping data, and he has like walls of map data and how things in the world are done and calculated and how things really are. Just showing all kinds of maps. Come to show you the last pictures. The Yes Man we also did projects with. And we had once a really, really widely mad with a lot of paintings work also. And then we had a workshop for kids because we encouraged them to also make art that they can secretly could with their own glue and their hammer. And then they also put paint to the real artworks. So it's all good to infiltrate and to put your own art wherever you want. Some stories are too long to tell, but it is also cool to look at. At the punk theme again, and beautiful aesthetics with the Russian hat with our Yaman IDs. This is Japanese. Cultural terrorist agencies. This is Heat Bunting again. How to do illegal tapping and all these interesting things that the public needs to know. Right, I'm with my sign, I have one last folder and I'm done. And this is going to be a small folder, so that's nice. Because this autumn there will be a new event at the Dutch Design Week. The Dutch Design Week is like the Milan. The Design Week is an event where like 260,000 visitors, often people that work in design, but also Coca-Cola and Philips, they want to give an assignment to young talents. And we want to shake them up because we think art is also an important part of design and about thinking about life. So I created an exhibition, Manifestations. You can visit it. It's the end of October in Eindhoven, and this is a young student work again. She did an implant that can monitor the levels of the nutrition being absorbed in your blood in real time from what you consume, so you can actually directly measure what it does to your body. And she has implants in the liver, in the stomach, so you can track all the enzymes and how they work. Why not? And this is another artist from the Netherlands. He created a mental institute for disturbed robots, like, I would love to show a video on this work, but there's probably no Wi-Fi on the laptop, is there? I'm not sure, I can try.
The connection is too weak here.
Yeah, okay, yeah. It's really the video, what you see is that there's this counter here, and you put some motor in it, so it turns around. This thing, and it hits the other device, and it goes on like crazy because it's a machine that cannot stop turning it around, and it just starts hitting and hitting and hitting. And if you put a couple of machines that are hitting each other in a cage, and it's a really disturbed effect of machines going crazy. And he actually analyzed furbies also in phobology. Their wishes and which part of the brain is used for suffering and temperament. Their insecurities. Oh yeah, here you see the cage where the robots are attacking each other. Case studies. Oh yeah, it's different. This is a girl from England. She does bio research on things that women can use, because a lot of when women have their period, you can put this plastic product in your underwear, and it's not really nice and sticky, and it creates a lot of fungus perhaps because it's plastic and it's not good, but the industry tells us that it's clean. So all the women are told all the time to have hairless bodies and to be clean, and then they have to buy. So what you see now is that more and more girls are also into this biohacking and researching if it is actually clean, and it's not clean at all because it's just plastic in a place where you should breathe. And she created this pad that really reads and inspects your hormones and the way your biofilm is there in the position located and supports it. And I think this is a good example of that you see more and more women coming up in art, because often, especially in the field of media art, it's always men that are doing the big famous things, like in science too. And I never look at the gender, but always at the quality of the work, but it's always like really sad that women sometimes are left behind, or you don't see them, or they're shouting less hard as the men sometimes shout. But now I see, when I only looked at the quality of the work of the people, that this year we have over 12 student works that I chose, there were 10 were women, and they were actually also thinking about how Internet of Things and how technology could help us. So not by creating an app that is connected to the cloud, so that Google and Apple could benefit, but also on but more about what people can use, how people are socially helped, or a woman and a child that are in trouble in the dark and in the night and they need help, and how do you help those people, or how can technology more help us, like seeing from female values perspective. And there's a scene coming up called the Internet of Women Things, and I like that. Oh, this is a man thing again, that's also nice. Don't worry. It's about how Putin and other leaders in the world, Angela Merkel, I don't know if you can read it, but Angela used her daughter here to use for propaganda and pictures, and Hillary Clinton, Geert Wilders, and Donald Trump uses his puppy. And Vladimir Putin uses also a puppy, so you see that they all use their super cute pets or kids to get more votes and see if you would vote. And then we always have a lot of events also at the Dutch Design Week called meetups or other ways of creating events that people can learn. Oh yeah, the modular body, also a nice video, look it up, the modularbody.com. It's about an artist called Phil Skyke, who said that the body is super stupid design, so he designed a new body. So he can actually replace the brain part and the lung parts and the limbs, and you can endlessly add limbs or whatever you like. So he made a smarter design using CG for the longer body, and the video went viral and had more than 1 million views. This one. Right, this is the exoskeleton that I just visited again, the prototypes, and the artist in Deventer in the Netherlands. This was an exhibition of technical tech that you want to show also at the Dutch Design Week, but they don't know yet, but we just copied emails of the videos that they use, so we don't just make something out of it, because we don't like copyright, and it's technical tech, you know, it's a privacy activist in Berlin, so I think that they won't mind, and I guess them also, so. And a lot of artists experimenting again with cleaning up plastic from the water, using plastic to grow biocells, smell of data when there's a website that is smelly because it doesn't treat your data well. A security cam artworks, a lot of VR dream worlds. Oh yeah, the Internet of Women things. This is, by the way, this is the wife of Bruce Sterling, that was the science fiction writer that I referred to earlier. He once invented together with William Gibson the word cyberpunk in cyberspace. And he wrote Neuromancer, and his wife is a feminist, and they now have another art space with Fab Lab in Turin in Italy. So they're doing quite promising things. It's also a thing that I like, it is also going to be next October. It's about that you can, this is Zauber in Toekomst, make, dream about what future you want to have, like an eye care carpet takes wherever you want, or love arrows that are bombs upside down, because where they land, suddenly there is peace instead of war, and playing with backup wings, when your wings would break off, and you have some backup wings, and they have all these, in Holland it often rains, so they even, the kids were thinking about a machine that sucks up the clouds, like a vacuum cleaner for clouds, and puts them out in Africa, because it's always dry, and the kids are thirsty there, and spits them out again, so. And meanwhile, these also start with dreaming, and so it's not only about tech or part of tech, you know, it's always nice to look at this whole thing and also to inspire people to dream again. Like, what kind of impossible machines would you like for your future? And it's also a nice video, if you would make notes, I would write this one down because it's super cool to see. Hyper-reality. Oh yeah, this you probably know, it's Monochrome from Austria. They did a new movie, just came out, Trace Roots. It's a road movie on the nerd culture. You probably like that. It's also a hacker slash artist of Johannes Grenzfurter. You probably know this guy, no? Definitely a friend of him, so mop bag, because people always leave their stuff behind expecting other people to clean it, and there's a Burning Man vibe coming up more and more, so it would be good to to have people more aware that they can also just clean up other people's trash, matter out of place, brush. It's a Burning Man team, and this artist, she also created signs in the train, we have now in the Netherlands in the trains silence coupes where you cannot speak. So she also thought it would be nice to have a place where you can speak with each other, like a social place. And this is a bicycle loan where you're officially allowed to sing on the bike. Because normally when you're biking, you're singing like and then you see another bike and really quietly singing along and hoping that they didn't hear you. But this is so it says no strange breaks in your pauses in your song because somebody is passing you, so you can just sing as loud as you want, la la, all the time, because why not? And it's been hung up now in the heavens here and there. Some people that I work with in the team, virtual world artist Lisa, also a student. And it's a woman that creates her own virtual world, and sometimes I'm also prejudged, and I was first thinking like which man would have helped her to create this virtual world. Stupid, I don't think these things. But then when I heard that she did it, and I see it in the details also, that she really created this beautiful dream world. Like her reading this young boy's book with a digital quest into this country out of space, and she actually created that. Oh yeah, transport to Oyster Card in London and fingernails. guy in the management this thing in his hand a couple of months ago. So he used it to check in out of the train, and actually has the Dutch transport say that's okay. This is Manuel Bertrand. He has created a bodysuit with heat sinks, so the guards lying there in the suit. Its body heat generates power. Power generates powers a Raspberry Pi, and the Raspberry Pi uses that for data mining bitcoins. So it's actually used as a speculative capital for bitcoin mining. And why not? Building. It's also a temporary old Philips building that is, not in use. So artists are now using it, and they wanted to make this into the biggest mega space in Europe. Always big business and trying to get money in, of course. This is about password rituals and privacy, created by a woman again, Password Club. It's about identity and security and privacy. It's glass masks, which we don't want our faces scanned anymore by governments. This is also against facial scanning and kind of burqa thing with all kinds of face parts printed on it. Also made by a girl. It's about a Palestinian girl that also tries to protest against current things that enter her world. Like her mother was looking for a husband with an EU passport to get documents here, and then she had to wait. She was born in Germany, and she had to wait 24 years to get papers, so she could never work or study, and finally when she was 24 years old, she could start her study. So a lot of, a lot of people happen this to, and they feel really strange, because, I mean, they were born in Germany, and her parents were also born in a refugee camp in near Palestina, because the Israelis threw them out because they needed this land, and then they went to a refugee camp, and now she's treated like this, like 24 years not being normal German citizens. Kind of weird to be born in Germany, because we have this whole culture of kids and people happening this to now, and they also have Facebook accounts, so they communicate using Facebook language. Now it's treasured again. Okay, now this was all the pictures. How long did I talk? An hour? Seems
yes.
So, eh? Okay, are there any questions? Are you too shy? Or do you just still think that art is weird and you just think, ah, different world, too arty for me? Did it help? Oh, yes.
You mentioned this movie, Trace Route.
Yeah.
Did you have any part in making it, or
no?
Rachel? Okay.
So, but if you, it's a exciting movie because for me it resonates on so many things that I relate to. So it's partly also my history. I can totally identify with the movie in many aspects. Interesting.
Can you remind us? More or less what you said in the beginning, like, why did you choose all this material to show?
Now here? No, do you mean? Okay, well, one of the things was that I work in the team where this camp was on, security, privacy, and hacking, because I do the same thing, but then from an art angle since last 10 years or so we worked with our hacked industry, robots and exoskeletons of the power of Google and the grand Coca-Cola bar and a lot of activism things. And I see that there are shared values with the hacker culture. And I also refer to the talk of Alec Empire, where he hoped that the hacker and the art culture would work more with each other, because they have so many shared ideas and their extreme big possibilities, but a lot of hackers still think that art is just deco and paintings, and actually that's not the case. It's really inspiring people, and there's a lot of overlap between those two cultures, and I wanted inspire you and make connections.
So do you have a can show in I don't know, maybe the one where you see that there is a more close connection and explain where is this connection or how does it work?
Well, I think that in a lot of these artwork works, hackers also have a role. We were also doing the chip card hacks. We were questioning the power of Google. Lots of like exoskeletons, how they work. It's also testing out. So it's a lot of hackers also work on the things that we do. And I cannot give a well. Actually, a lot of these things that are shown are also things that were made together with hackers or people that do, or students of the art academies that first did a technical study. But I see a lot of opportunities because artists use the same ideals to achieve attention and understanding from a broad audience to inspire them using the fun element, but also to bring them into the depth more and to teach them a story or to tell the audience a story on the actual state of affairs in society today about the role of the government or the role of big companies and how we can also look at that. And we also put a lot of popular culture in because that's really like here and now and new, and it's really connecting with the new generation of kids who less and less reads newspapers. Yes?
My question would be, you obviously showed us a lot of work which requires technical things to get done, like electronics, software, and all kinds of stuff like that. Which requires our expert knowledge. How often is it that the expert is the artist? As in, the artist does not just provide the concept and the looks, but rather the software, the electronics inside.
Different. There are people that do. The question is how often is it the artist that does all the technical parts or not? Like doing the software. Well, it is different. You have like several people. Some people just hire technical people to like the guy that did the exoskeleton only made the shiny metal parts, and he hires a technical guy to do all the techniques in the box that connects the exoskeleton with the robot, and the guy is called Mr. Stock, and he's often hired for his projects of artists wanting these kind of things. But often artists first do a technical study or they research themselves. That's also happening a lot. So a lot of people, artists are also technical themselves or they find things out. When I was teaching at a university, it was a technical university, so all the students there, they do programming, so I was more teaching them arts also and to be creative. And then there is also a hacker group called Modderlab that was also active in Berlin, and they were doing like the BitTorrent plugin for Firefox. What was it called again? Pirates of the Amazon. So if you wanted to buy a book on Amazon, you could either buy the book or the movie, or you could click on the BitTorrent download now button, and then it got sued by Amazon, of course, because Amazon didn't like this Firefox plugin. But so this was actually a group of hackers that were working in the artist scene. So it's really different. So either they hire people, or they co-work with people, or they work in a group, or they have regular people that they ask, or they are hackers or programmers themselves.
What are these objects in front of your laptop?
Oh yeah, what these objects are, small books with pictures of previous things I did, and I thought maybe you would like to look at them or take them home. This one was from India, where I did a project, and these are other things. Oh, mosquito. But I would also like it if you would think not only about creating stuff because it's only open source, or does an artist also like to have the perfect mosquito killer, or also would like to have often when I'm in the bed and I'm tired and wake up in the morning, I would really die to find out the thing that takes my pee out of my bladder, so I don't have to wake up, walk downstairs in the cold on my bare feet to the toilet, try to pee, go back and hope that I fall asleep again. I mean, these kind of things, and thinking the other way around on the things that we actually need and the things that people need and our body needs and society needs. That's really also nice that we don't just think about the things that exist or the things that we want to follow, but also the things that we feel and need and want or help. Or it's yeah, really nice to turn all these perspectives all the way around often. I don't know if it's always art, but yeah, it's playing and fun. Why not? Yes.
Yeah, you say that artists and hackers can work together, and could you, I don't know, how do you find your art skin as a hacker? Do you have any recommendations on getting known to artists?
Yeah, I understand that question. I was also thinking about this. Well, what you could do is look more to the... Oh yeah, the question is how can a hacker find a media artist to work with? I was also thinking about this, and one of the things is to maybe more visit the media art exhibitions or festivals that you see, because often people block out what they think is bad, and maybe it is bad, it's possible, but you always need to look them up or visit these things and then see what happens. You can also look online more, you can email me, of course. Let's see, how do you meet artists? I was teaching at universities and schools. There are so many places where artists go to. Especially their own exhibitions and the graduation art shows. But the first step is more opening your mind towards these things, and then you will see more opportunities. And my goal was to open your mind, and I would love to help you with the next steps in the future private conversations. Yes?
Another question. You got this robot arm playing music, an industrial robot arm, which is, how do you get that robot arm? It looks quite expensive.
Robot arm?
Your first picture is an industrial robot which plays music, and it looks very expensive.
You want one also to play with. Yeah, that is, the question was on how do you get an industrial robot arm to play with. And there are always ways. There are artist groups like the Critical Art Ensemble, which create this work, but also survival research labs in the 80s. They also took a lot of industrial stuff to play with. And they find these things in Germany, but they also just visit. That's what we also do, just go to an industrial area, knock on the door, and just ask the old steel guy, hey, do you have some old steel, and can I look around here, and then see what you find, and then create your own bar using that old steel. And we have then, where I live, there is a local place that sells all the old factory stuff. So they sell all the old, so you pay per kilogram, and you can buy all the old industry equipment there. And for me, it was like pouring. It was like industry pouring. I was like ruining all the 4 hours that I was out until I got pushed out when they were closing. But it was in factories, they have all these beautiful technological shapes and things, and they are for sale. Just go to a place, ask around, and also ask metal artists or other artists that you see when they got it. Just ask, ring the door, ask. Google doesn't give these answers. I always go to the to the destruction sites and to the trash depots where you can bring your trash, and it's absolutely not allowed to take trash, but I always take trash. I always get in and say, I have to tell you a secret, but you cannot tell anybody, I'm not here to bring trash, I'm here to take a little bit of trash for the art projects. And I say, and I think it's coffee time, so I think you look that way, and I'm done in 5 minutes. And they actually do that in every town where I pick up trash. They just do it, and then you find the most wonderful stuff there. And just going to an industrial area and ask. I also was in a store where they were using, they had this rich people design stuff, and they had this lamp, also made out of old industry things, and the owner was so proud that he made it himself, and he exactly told me where he found the elements, and I said, to know this place, but it was the industry porn place where you get to find all the industry equipment. Asking, not googling, not searching, or whichever search.